Good morning. It is lovely to see everyone out this morning. We are going to remain seated while we sing our very first hymn, Here I Am to Worship.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to your service here in First Broughshane this morning. A special word of welcome to any visitors here with us, especially the members of the various organisations. You're very welcome as we worship together. And a warm word of welcome to Reverend Dickey back amongst us to speak. And we pray that God will speak to us through him as we worship him this morning. Just a few announcements to go through. Well, more than a few. So just bear with me, please, as we go through them. The BB enrolment service is tonight in 2nd Broughshane. And please note it's at 6 o'clock instead of 6:30 as on the announcement sheet. Monday evening is Ruling Elders Fellowship at 8 p.m. in Trinity of Hochul, when Reverend John Mullen will be speaking about the Lord's Supper. And this means that the Elders' Bible Elders' Prayer Meeting for Monday night is cancelled. Tuesday Fellowship meets this Tuesday at 2:30 in St. Patrick's, and the speaker will be Reverend Alistair McCracken. GB meets at the usual time on Tuesday evening. And then also there's the prayer time here in the church building at 8 o'clock on Tuesday evening. Wednesday Friends will meet at 10:30 down in 2nd on Wednesday. And the PW meets this Wednesday at 8 p.m. Elma Leeburn from Sat 7 will be coming along to tell of their work in the Middle East. All ladies welcome, and please note the change of venue to Broughshane House just next door. So that's 8 o'clock on Wednesday for the PW. Also for the PW, a reminder of the Christmas dinner on Wednesday the 6th of December in the Carry at Kells, arriving after 7 for a 7:30 start. Cost is £25 for two courses, and there is a sheet here on the communion table to sign up and choose your menu. Please see Janice for payment, and all ladies welcome. Thursday evening then is Men Alive in Broughshane House at 8 p.m., The speaker is Ivan Johnson from Good News for Everyone, formerly known as the Gideons. And all men will be very welcome at 8 p.m. in Broughshane House. And just a wee note, if you're coming to the meetings in Broughshane House, please arrive in good time, as the front door has to be locked for security reasons when the meetings are going on. So if you come after 8 o'clock, you might not get in. Friday evening then at 7:30, there is a table quiz in 2nd Broughshane, organised by the BB. Adults £5 and teenagers £3, and all proceeds are in support of Andrew and the Logan family. So then next Sunday, Sunday school and morning service at the usual times, and the speaker next Sunday will be Andy Williamson. I'm sure you know Ronnie is on study leave this week. If you require a minister during this period, contact an elder. And next Sunday evening, Connect will meet at 6:30. In Broughshane House. Finally, there will be mission meetings in Broughshane Orange Hall this week from Monday until Friday, each evening at 8 p.m. with music from local bands, and everyone is welcome. These are all announcements, I hope. Just want to hand over now to Mr. Dickey. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan, for your welcome here today. It is a particular privilege and a pleasure to be back once again in this pulpit and to share with you and to see a full church here today. We come to worship a great and a wonderful God. We live in a very broken and torn world in these days, but we have a marvelous prospect that is ahead of us, that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will return. And he will consummate his great kingdom. He will bring all things to their glorious end. And I want us today, and I'll be preaching later on about this, I want us to lift our hearts and our eyes heavenward and to see the glory of our God and of our Christ, and particularly of his return again. So we're going to join together. We'll stand to sing together the hymn, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory of the Coming of the Lord."
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming.
restored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, be soul to answer. Oh, be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching. The glory of the morning on the wave. He is wisdom to the mighty. He is succor to the brave. So the world shall be his footstool, and the soul of time his slave. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching.
Ah, let's unite our hearts together as we come to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father, we pray that you will still our hearts as we come into your presence. We thank you that you are the Lord of Lords, you are the King of Kings, you are the mighty God, the Creator of all things, the one who has fashioned the universe and filled it, the God who has made us in your own image that we might reflect and live to your glory. We come, we know, to a throne of majesty, of unapproachable light, to the God who is thrice holy, the one who is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. And Lord, As we consider that, we are made a conscious again of our own unworthiness, even to approach you. For we are very conscious, Lord, of our sinnerhood. We are the children of Adam. We are the children of the fall. And we come into your presence today, acknowledging, Lord, that there is no good thing in us. There is no deserving thing in us that we should be able to approach you. We readily confess our sin today. We thank you, Father, that there is an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. We praise and thank you today for your Son, whom you sent into this world, who came willingly that he might be a Savior to sinners like us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were willing to go all the way to that cross and there to offer your life as sacrifice for the sin of the world. And we praise you that with that finished work, we may know the peace and the joy of sins forgiven and acceptance with God. That we can, as the apostle encourages us, we can approach the throne of your majesty and your glory, and we can come with confidence in our hearts because of Jesus. And we can come, Lord, where we may find that mercy to cover all our sin and that promised grace to help in every time of need. We bless and thank you for your Holy Spirit poured out upon the church, given to us, the Spirit of all grace, the Spirit of all truth, the one who has come to take the things of Christ and to make them known to us and to lead us and guide us and sanctify us. And we pray, Lord, that in this time of worship together, that your Spirit will attend every aspect of it, and that all things will redound to the praise, the honor, and the glory of our God and of our Savior Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now we'll stand together for our act of remembrance. Thank you. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We may be seated for prayer. Let us pray. Today, let us remember with thanksgiving those who have made the supreme sacrifice for us in time of war. Let us pray that the offering of their lives may not have been in vain, and may we in our day dedicate ourselves to the cause of justice, freedom, and peace, and for wisdom and strength to build a better world. Almighty God, in whose hands are the destinies of this and of every nation, we bring our thanks today for the peace and the security that we enjoy. We remember with gratitude those who laid down their lives to defend our liberties. Today we pray for their families, and for ourselves whose freedom was won at such a cost, gratefully remembering their courage and their sacrifice. Lord, make us a people zealous for peace, and hasten that day when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither learn war anymore. Lord, make your ways known upon the earth, your saving power among the peoples. Renew your church in holiness. Help us to serve you with joy. Guide, we pray, the leaders of all nations, that justice may prevail throughout the world. Let not the needy be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Lord, make us instruments of your peace, and let your glory be over all the earth. We pray for peace, for justice and reconciliation in Ukraine, in the Middle East, and in other parts of your world today. We pray for the honoring of human rights, for the relief of the oppressed. We pray for the safety and the welfare of members of the British Armed Forces on active service. Lord, be near to them and their loved ones in times of anxiety and uncertainty, and bring them safely home. We pray for those who have survived the hostilities and destruction of war, but bear the physical and the mental scars of conflict. Lord, bring healing to shattered bodies and minds, and inspire with new purpose for the future. May we all have the grace to live in a spirit of justice, of generosity, and of peace. And all this, Lord, we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Now we're going to sing together the hymn, Abide With Me. And during the hymn, the offering will be taken up by members of the Royal British Legion.
Thank you.
this point, I'm going to read just a few verses from the last book of the New Testament, the revelation that was given to John. And then after we read these few verses, we'll sing again the hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants what must soon take place. And he made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is he who reads aloud the words of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written therein, for the time is near. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, every one who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen.
Of Christ, my God.
Some 10 minutes ago, I heard the ping of the clock. That used to be a signal that time was up. I didn't pay any attention to it then. I'll probably pay little attention to it today. But it was always at 1 o'clock when I was here before that it pinged, so we have plenty of time. That's just a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, now as we turn to your word, this word of truth, we pray that your Holy Spirit will give us minds to understand, to appreciate it, hearts to embrace it, and a willingness to go out from this place and to live our lives in the light of it. And this we ask in the name of Christ. Amen. The revelation of John, sometimes called the Apocalypse, it takes its name, that particular name, from the opening words of the book, the Apocalypsis in the Greek, the Apocalypsis of Jesus Christ. It's what is known as apocalyptic literature. That's its type, that's its genre of literature. Not apocalyptic in the modern popular sense of catastrophe, but rather as an unveiling or a disclosure of things not previously known and which could only be known by revelation. So it's revelation, it's an unveiling, it's a disclosure, we are told, of what must soon take place. Now we notice that this revelation is given by God and it's given through Jesus. It's not the revelation of John, as some mistakenly call it, but it's the revelation of Jesus Christ given by God to John. It's a revelation by Jesus and it's also the revelation about Jesus. He is the content of this revelation, as well as the one who discloses it. We're told that it's shown to John and it is made known to John. We see that in the first verse. Literally, it is signified. That's the meaning, the literal meaning of the term. It's signified to John. And so we expect to find in this book a great deal of what we might call signs or symbolism. It's a book of vision, vision after vision, full of symbolism. It's something like a picture book. It's not a puzzle book, which must be deciphered in every detail that we have here. Many there are who have attempted to do that and to interpret everything, every detail, and what a mess at times they get into trying to do that. No, it's more like a picture book. It's revelation, which is shown to John. We find throughout this book, time and time again, John is saying, I looked and I saw. I looked and behold, I saw. It's throughout the whole book. And as John bears witness to the word of God, as it says here, he bears witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Verse 2. And you see, as John bears witness, as John witnesses all that is set before him, we too are drawn into it so that we too can see, so that we too can say, I understand this, I can see this. This is what I see about my sovereign Lord, because it's all about Jesus. This is what I see about my Savior, the Lord Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Jesus, the one who is, as it says here, the Alpha and the Omega in verse 8, the one who is, who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. It's about Jesus in verse 5, the one who is the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, the ruler of kings on earth. It's about Jesus in verse 6, who is the Lamb, and chapter 5, verse 6, Jesus who is the Lamb in the midst of the throne. Jesus who is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, who has conquered. So this apocalypse, this revelation, is all about Jesus. And it's all about the glory of Jesus. It's about the glory of a conquering king. It's about the glory of a warrior king. It's all about Jesus coming to subdue and to defeat and destroy his archenemy, Satan, together with all of Satan's minions. Jesus coming in judgment. Find that in chapter 17, 19, for example. It's about Jesus the King coming to finally consummate his kingdom of peace, to redeem the universe, to usher in a new creation, a new heavens and a new earth. Chapters 21, 22. It's about Jesus the Redeemer coming to gather to himself the elect from every nation, every tongue, and every tribe. It's about Jesus, the bridegroom, who's coming to claim his bride, the church, his chosen people, who in an indissoluble union with him share in the glory and the victory of Christ in the great marriage supper of the Lamb, chapter 19. So John's repeated refrain that we find throughout this book, I looked, behold, I saw, invites you and me to look and to see the glory of Jesus, our Messiah. And all of that, of course, to the end that we might fall at his feet, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and that we might worship him, joining together with the heavenly host in chapter 5 and verses 11 to 14 around the throne of God and the Lamb, and singing, Worthy is the Lamb. Now, that's just the introduction. That's not the sermon. So we're going to turn over to chapter 19. If you want to look it up, if you have a Bible there, there might be one in front of you in the pew. In Revelation chapter 19, to begin with, I want to read from verse 11. John speaking of what he saw. 19 verse 11, Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. He who sat upon it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, on his head are many diadems. He has a name inscribed which no one knows but himself. He is clad in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, followed after him on white horses. From his mouth issues a sharp sword with which to smite the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name inscribed, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. John says, I saw heaven opened. And that was a great encouragement and assurance to the apostle, because John was writing in a time of suffering. The church was suffering persecution. This was around 95 AD, persecuted under the Emperor Domitian. A man who called himself the August One, who took the title of Savior, who assumed the title of Lord, and even called himself God. And he had statues erected throughout his empire requiring offering and sacrifice as evidence of the people's allegiance to him. Now, Christians for whom there is only one God and there's only one Lord, Jesus Christ, refusing to join in the idolatry, they would be arrested, dispossessed, many of them put to death. John himself was in exile on the island of Patmos. And from this earthly perspective, things were dire. These were dark days for the church. So the Lord, you see, draws back the curtain, and John's eyes are lifted heavenward. to see things from a different, from a heavenly perspective. And what does he see? He sees a rider on a white horse. It's a sign of a victor, someone who has defeated his enemies and so on. And he takes center stage in these verses 11 to 16 of John 19. And we're told that in righteousness, he judges and he makes war. Now, who is he? What is his name? Verse 12, we're told he has a name which no one knows but himself. Now, you see, in Scripture, the name signifies the character of a person. The name sums up the whole person. It discloses all that there is to know of someone. Now, this person has a name that no one knows but himself. He is incomprehensible to us. He's unfathomable to us. He's beyond human ability to fully comprehend. And we can only know what he chooses to reveal of himself. So what does he reveal of himself? Well, verse 11, we are told he is called faithful and true. In verse 13, the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And in verse 16, on his robe and on his thigh, he has a name inscribed, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So who is he? We know who he is, don't we? This is Jesus, none other than Jesus. Jesus, who is the faithful witness of chapter 1 and verse 5. Jesus, whom the Apostle John, who writes this book, had declared in his gospel in chapter 1 that he is the Word, who was in the beginning, who was with God, who was God. The Word who became flesh and dwelt amongst men, and he's full of grace and truth. This is Jesus who says of himself in John chapter 14, I am the truth. He's the personification of truth. All of truth is wrapped up in him. This is Jesus who now reigns and rules from heaven, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jesus who in righteousness, verse 11, judges and makes war. This is a warrior king. Jesus, the warrior king, who's riding out amongst the nations, conquering and to conquer. And how does he conquer? Verse 15, it says, from his mouth issues a sharp sword with which to smite the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. In chapter 1 and 16, in that vision of Jesus, it's called a sharp, two-edged sword. It's a sword of his word, his mighty word. Remember how it's recorded in the letter to the Hebrews in chapter 4. And verse 12 says, the word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are open and laid bare of the eyes with him, of him with whom we have to do. The enemies of Christ are slain by the breath of his mouth. It tells us that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And indeed we find this in the rest of this chapter, from verse 17 onwards, or verse 19 onwards. I'm not going to go into it just now. This vision not only declares what Jesus will do at the last day when he returns again, but what he has always been doing since Calvary. Did you notice verse 13 as we read it? He is clad in a robe dipped in blood or sprinkled in blood. And the name by which he is called is the Word of God. Whose blood is that? Some say it's the blood of his enemies as he goes out to conquer and to destroy and to judge. Maybe. Bay includes that. But notice that it's mentioned here before the engagements of verse 15 ever take place. And I think what we are to see here is Christ's own blood, the blood of the cross. We are told by the Apostle Paul in Colossians 2 and 15, it says of him that he disarmed the principalities and the powers. That's Satan and all his minions. He disarmed the principalities and the powers and made a public example of them, listen, triumphing over them in the cross. It's in the cross. So Jesus rides out in the power of the gospel, the word of the gospel, the sharp two-edged sword that issues from his mouth. Remember, it's pictorial language, symbolism. And he rides out on the basis of the victory that he has already won through the cross of Calvary. And did you notice too that in verse 14 it says this, the armies of heaven arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, followed him on white horses. He's an army that follows him. Now, some would say that's the angels of heaven. Well, it may include the angels of heaven, but I think in the whole context, it is rather the saints of God. It's the church of Jesus Christ. It's the people of God on the march with their warrior king. And the church of Christ, you see, if you're a believer today, you belong to that church. The church of Jesus Christ is and will be triumphant because it follows and we follow in the train of the conquering King of Kings, the faithful and the true, the mighty Word of God. We have the victory. We have that victory in Christ and because of Christ. We have that victory over sin and death and the grave and Satan. Doesn't always appear that way, does it? And doesn't the Apostle Peter warn us in his first epistle, chapter 5 and 8, he reminds us that the devil, your adversary, goes around like a prowling lion, seeking whom he may devour. Satan is powerful, more powerful than we are. And he's active, and he's out to destroy. He's out to destroy the church of Jesus Christ. That's his target. He's out to destroy the testimony of the gospel. But you know, he cannot win. He cannot ultimately do that. If we look and if we listen, in Revelation chapter 19, or Revelation chapter 20. In Revelation chapter 20, we read this. Then I saw, John again, he sees heaven opened, he sees these things. I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he sees the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan. He bound him for 1,000 years, and he threw him into the pit and shut it and sealed it over him, that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years were ended. And then he must be loosed for a little while. Satan is chained today. Satan is constrained today. He's bound, says this text. In this present church age, we might call it, he's curtailed, he's limited. An angel comes. Jesus is that angel. And he has done that. He has bound Satan. How has Jesus bound Satan? Well, if we go back to Jordan, if we go back to the Gospels and to the River Jordan, and how Jesus is baptized there by John, and what happens, the Spirit comes and empowers Jesus. Spirit comes upon him to empower him for his ministry that lies ahead of him, for his whole mission in the world. And what do we find? We find that immediately the Spirit drives him out into the wilderness. to confront Satan. And Jesus overcomes Satan and all the temptations of Satan there. When the devil would tempt him with all the powers of the world, he would give him the kingdoms, he said. He would give him all these things if he had only bowed down and worship him. Those weren't Satan's to give. Those belonged to God. Those belonged to Christ. Jesus says, it is written, it is written, it is written. The mighty word of God. And Satan slinks away. If we trace Jesus' ministry from then, he's going about and what's he doing? He's casting out demons. And the Pharisees came on one occasion and they said, it's only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this man, Jesus, casts out demons. Remember what Jesus said? How can anyone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Strong man there, in Jesus' words, is Satan. And Jesus said, if I'm casting out demons, how can I do that unless I have first bound him? In Luke 10, we're told about the mission of the 70 followers of Jesus whom he sent out to go before him. And in Luke 10, 17, they come back and they say, Lord, even the demons are subject to you, to us, subject to us in your name. And Jesus said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions, that is demons and devils, and over all the power of the enemy. And then finally, through the cross and the resurrection, that's not finally for the sermon, by the way, but Jesus' ministry, through the cross and the resurrection, what do we find? Death is overcome. He rises. The grave is overcome. He rises from the grave. Satan is defeated. The grave has lost its power. Satan is chained. The first time I drove into George McMullen's yard, George, you may remember that, I parked the car in the backyard, got out of the car and headed over towards the back door. And suddenly there was something like an Exocet missile came from the other side, teeth bared, snarling. I froze to the spot. And then suddenly, at a particular point, the chain tightened and the dog did a somersault within a few meters of me. I was glad that chain was there and that the chain held. Next time I could come to the yard and I could smile at the dog because I knew that he was bound and he had only power within the compass of that chain. Satan may prowl around like a roaring lion, but he's on a chain and the sphere of his activity is curtailed. We're told in verse 3 of chapter 20, so that he should deceive the nations no more, until the 1,000 years are ended. 1,000 years, I believe, persuaded of it, is not any literal 1,000 years, but it is the church age from the time of Christ's first advent to the time when he returns again. It's the age of the church and it's the age of world mission, and Satan is curtailed. Don't we see that? Following the apostles, they went out to preach in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the end, uttermost parts of the earth. And by the 4th century, Christianity was the official religion of the Roman Empire. And we see how that is spread, even to our own day, throughout the nations of this world. Satan cannot deceive the nations. He's chained, and the gospel has free course. Now we know that in many places in the world today, he exerts his power. He seeks many to devour. And we know that the Christian church is suffering horrendously in many places today. But the gospel still goes forward. And in places where we wouldn't expect it, what's happening? The church is growing. The kingdom of Christ is growing, and it's strong and it's powerful. It may be small, but it's testifying to the glory and the greatness of the Savior. Remember how the risen Savior commissioned the church, Matthew 28 and 18 onwards. He said, "All authority in heaven and earth is given to me. Go you, therefore, and make disciples of what? Of all nations. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the world." Christ is riding out, as it were, on the white horse of victory and conquest. And the saints of Christ, the church of Christ, follow in his wake, testifying to him and to his great name as the Savior of sinners, as the King of kings and the Lord of lords. This is the age of mission. It began in Jerusalem. It has spread to the ends of the earth. And Jesus says, "I will build my church, and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Christ's church is on a war footing. And if you're a believer today, if you're a Christian today, you've got to accept that, and you've got to understand that, and you've got to adopt that you're on a war footing. And we need to be alert. We need to be armed against the evil one, for he's still very active. He may be in a chain, but he's still very active, and we need to be armed against him. Remember how the Apostle Paul puts it in Ephesians chapter 6, this well-known passage. Ephesians 6 and 10, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might." That's heartening, isn't it? It's not our own strength. It's not our own might. The strength of the Lord and his might. "Put on," he says, "the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." He's a clever old creature. He's a deluder and a deceiver. We are not contending against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. The Christian church is a church militant, the church at war against great spiritual forces. "Therefore, take the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having girded your loins with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the equipment of the gospel of peace. Besides all this, taking the shield of faith, with which you can quench all the flaming darts of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert, with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints." We need to do that. We need to be doing that now, because a day is coming when Satan will be loosed from his chain. Says that in verse 7. It reminds us of that in chapter 20 and verse 7. When the 1,000 years are ended, when this church age, as it were, comes towards its end, Satan will be loosed from his prison, and he will come out to deceive the nations at the four corners of the earth. He comes out to gather them, as it were, for battle. A final effort by Satan to destroy the church and the testimony of Jesus Christ. It says here, surrounding the camp of the saints and the beloved city. The church of Jesus Christ, if we have our eyes opened at all today, we surely can perceive that. Do we not discern it today? That the powers of ungodliness, the power and the spirit of Antichrist is set against Christ and against his church. We can see it vividly in other parts of the world today, where Christians are being martyred, are being destroyed. Whole communities of Christians in parts of Africa and other places of the world today. Do we see it in our own community, in our own situation here where we live in the West? We don't have that kind of persecution. But we have all the subtlety and the wiles of the evil one as he seeks to undermine society, the foundations of our society, as he seeks to destroy the fabric of our society, as we see the whole idea and the institution of marriage, and people are making a mess of it. And we see it in our educational system. We see it in our little children being subjected to things that are ungodly. Spirit of Antichrist. As John says in his epistle in 1 John, the spirit of Antichrist, it's among us now. It's here. It was there in his day. And it's here in our day as well. And the church has been pressed in from all sides by the power of evil, restricted and manipulated by Satan. Christians can't even pray in public today in parts of the street silently. Can't preach in the streets at times. Their words are monitored, and some are taken from the very streets and they're arrested and so on. It's happening in our world here. It'll get worse. Scripture says it'll get worse. Satan will be loosed. But thank God it is only for a short time. It's for a little period wherein he's trying to gather all the ungodly forces of this world against the church of Jesus Christ and the witness of the church. But listen, we are told here that despite all of that, fire will come down from heaven from God and they will be consumed. It's all in the Lord's sovereign control. Who is it that binds Satan? Well, Jesus does. Why? So that the gospel might be preached into all the world. Who looses Satan for a small period? Jesus does. Why? To bring the church's warfare to an end. It's all orchestrated by God himself. And the message of this book is a simple one. It's a simple one. If we get that right, we'll get all the rest falling into place. I read somewhere recently, theological seminary somewhere in the United States, and some of the students at theological seminary were having a stroll in the campus grounds, and they came across the gardener, the old gentleman who looked after the grounds. He was sitting on the seat and he was reading. And he came to him in the conversation, "What are you reading?" He says, "I'm reading the book of Revelation." And he said, "Do you understand it?" He said, "I do." He was a simple, uneducated man. He said, "I understand it." And they said, these theological students said, "Well, do you not need us to explain to you some of these symbols and all that we find in Revelation?" "No," he says, "I understand it." And they said to him, "Well, what's that about then?" He says, "Jesus wins." That's it. That's the message. Jesus wins. Jesus wins. And because he wins, the church wins. His people win. The gospel wins. Truth wins. That's the final end. So just as a close, it's not going to ping for another while yet. Just as a close, how will it be for you? How will it be for me on that great day when Christ comes? The final battle, all is over. How will it be for you? Well, let me ask you this. How is it for you today? How is it for you now, today? As you sit here in this church, are you on the winning side?
Are you for Christ or not? Jesus says, he who is not for me is against me. Are you for him? Are you on his side? Have you the victory? Are you sure of that? That you have the confidence because you're trusting in Jesus and you're following in his train and you're riding on a white horse. You're victors. Have you that assurance? I trust and I pray that you will have if you don't have it already. Look to him. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the one who's directing history towards its appointed end, and what a glorious end it is when he comes again. Trust him today. There's no other way. Let's pray together. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, this good news that Jesus is the victor, that he who directs history towards its appointed end is the one who rides out through the world, and his gospel goes powerfully into all countries, all nations, and is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes. We pray, Holy Spirit, you'll bring this word home to our hearts, that it may find a place there, that we will embrace this truth, that we embrace the one who is the truth, even Jesus Christ, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Savior of sinners. We ask it in his name. Amen. We'll sing in closing our service, Be Thou My Vision.
Be all as two.
Following the benediction, we remain standing for the national anthem. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
God save our gracious King.